Pulse response simulation in Hyperlinks 2.8 will allow you to do analysis even when you don't have simulation models for the parts that you're trying to analyze. This is particularly useful when you're just trying to get a quick handle on signal quality and you don't want to go to all the time and effort of doing a detailed analysis. For example, if you have a board that's in the middle of routing, you can perform pulse response simulation to quickly get meaningful feedback to a layout designer within 15 to 30 minutes. Let's take a look in this particular example. We have a DDR4 bus here where we're looking at the address signals that have just been routed, and we want to compare these different signals in the bus for signal quality and consistency. To do that, what we'll do is we'll select pulse response simulation, and we'll tell it to use the nets that we've already simulated in the board, and we can configure the characteristics for the drivers and the receivers because this is a model-free simulation. So we're going to use a typical DDR4 output driver, maximum strength, 34 ohms. Our input receivers actually don't have termination, so we'll just make it high impedance. Our input pins are about a picofarad apiece in terms of capacitance. We're going to run this signal at our stretch goal of 3200 megabit, which is a 625 picosecond UI for the address bits. Rise-fall time is about 75 picoseconds, and our I/O voltages are 1.2 volts. So we'll tell the system that we want to drive from the controller and measure the signal quality at each of the different DRAMs, and we'll look at the waveforms when we're done just to get a sense of how things ran. Now, this is how quick this analysis actually runs. I'm running this in real time, and when it's done, it'll pull up a report that will give us a sense of signal quality. Now, this report reports signal quality in terms of eye area. If you think of an eye and you think of the open area of an eye and you measure that area, you would measure it in the units of something like volt picoseconds, which is what this report is reporting. And it's giving us a relative idea of how open the eye is, and it is also quantifying how much energy we're losing to inter-symbol interference. So because we've run a pulse response, we've characterized the pulse and the tail, we can characterize the area in the pulse itself, we can characterize the amount of energy that we're, or area that we're losing in the tail, and this is what we're left with in terms of our eye opening, and we can calculate the ratio of the signal to the noise in effect, and the higher this ratio is, the better off we are. In this particular case, address bit 13 turns out to be our lowest ratio, so it's our biggest problem, if you will, and we can come in here, we've asked it to save the waveforms, and we can pull up those signals and look at what happens with that signal as it propagates to those different DRAMs. Now, this type of behavior is pretty characteristic of DDR flyby topologies. The first DRAM in the series actually has the worst signal quality because of negative reflections from the signal as it hits the subsequent DRAMs down the daisy chain. The last DRAM in the daisy chain typically has the best signal integrity because it's also the closest to the terminator. This energy here is contributing the inter-symbol interference, and so it's the area under this part of the curve that is actually causing that ISI number. This is the area that we're losing, and this area in the main part of the pulse is the area that is the main signal. It's what we want to deliver to the load. Now, let's take a look at what happens if we go back and run this thing at a slightly slower speed. So we had an eye area of 242. We had a ratio of 3.4. We can come back and actually back off the speed on this interface. Let's back it down to 2400 megabit and rerun that and see what our results look like. And now what we see is if we slow the speed down on the interface, as we would expect, the numbers improve, our area goes up to 383, and our worst case number goes up to 4.74. Keeping that in mind, now let's go back and take crosstalk into account so that we can see how crosstalk is affecting the behavior of this interface as well. That's going to take a little bit longer to run, so we'll run crosstalk. We can control what nets are considered aggressors. We can actually set the thresholds for what qualifies as an aggressor net. And I'm going to come in here, and I'm going to turn off the waveforms on that one, and I'm going to let this analysis run. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring crosstalk into the equation at the lower speed. This simulation is going to take about 2 minutes to run, so I'm going to fast forward the video at this point so we don't have to watch all this. And here's our final result. And so as we can see, the eye area has decreased because we've included crosstalk. And now what you see is actually three numbers here. This is the energy in the pulse itself. This is the energy that we're losing to inter-symbol interference on the trace. This is the energy that we're losing to crosstalk. This is the energy that we're left with each of these eyes. And this is identifying where our best and worst case nets are. So that's how pulse response simulation works in Hyperlinks 2.8. We hope you give it a try for yourself.